morning.
Good morning.
It is good to see each of you here this morning. We, of course, as has been announced, we do have various ones who are not here. Some due to illness, we know. Some are traveling. I know that the Mankins are away traveling, and the Bentons, they're down, of course, helping out John's dad. We pray for each one. We keep them in our thoughts and minds. We hope that they will be back next week, be back soon. We have others who will be traveling, I know, next week, and we keep them in our prayers as well. We ask that you bow with me as we go to God in prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Humbly we bow before you this morning in prayer. Father, we praise you, we exalt your name. Father, we pray that you will forgive us of any sins that we have in our lives, Father, that our worship of you will not be hindered. Father, we pray that as we come here this morning, that all things will be done in a pleasing manner to you, Father. Father, we pray that you will strengthen us in your word, Father. We thank you for your word, for all that you have done for us. And Father, again, especially, we are mindful this morning of your word that has been given to us that we might learn your will and be obedient to it. Father, we pray this morning that as the lesson is presented, we pray, Father, that I will not get in the way of your word, that it will reach its mark, that each of us will have a heart, a mind ready to receive your word, Father, that we will apply these things to our lives and live accordingly, Father. In Christ's most precious and holy name we pray. Amen. If you were in the classes, of course, Jim has recently been recouping and has not been in the class. In a couple of the classes recently I covered. And those classes, as you know, we taught and studied the book of Nehemiah. And I hope and I pray, brothers and sisters, that if you were in that class, that the things we discussed were helpful, encouraging to you, informative to you, that you will think on those things, that you will apply them to your life, that you might be, that all of us might be what God would have us to do. As I indicated in the class, I want to look this morning at some of the things. We're not going to really go back over that class per se, but I want to use that as a jumping off point to what we are going to be getting into, and really goes along with the discussion that we're going to look at this morning. We looked, of course, in the book of Nehemiah in way of remembering, and for those of you who are not in the class, to kind of bring you to where we are, we looked and saw how that indeed three things are brought out. Of course, many things are brought out in this book, but three things that we looked at were the goals that Nehemiah had. Nehemiah, of course, desired to rebuild the walls and the city and all, and to restore the worship as well. We really didn't focus on the worship, but it is important to understand that his intent, his goal, his efforts also, and we bring in Ezra. Ezra is brought in to the picture. We know there is a book, Ezra, right before the book of Nehemiah, but he is also discussed in the book of Nehemiah, and you see him in chapter 8 and so forth. But you see these goals that are brought forth. We also noted that there were obstacles that were before Nehemiah. For example, in the very first chapter of Nehemiah, we find an obstacle that he faced. And that was the situation that they were in. In Nehemiah 1 and verse 3, "And they said unto me, The remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. And as we indicated, as we discussed in the classes that we were looking at this, of course we know that this is an obstacle for him. He could have simply thrown up his hands and said, well, look at the situation, and it is too great for us. It is too great for me to be able to do anything about. It can't be fixed. But that wasn't his reaction, was it? His first reaction was he wept. He was mournful for the situation. It saddened him that this was the condition that his people were in, that the city was in. But then he prayed. And you can read in chapter 1, verses 5, down through the end of the chapter, you can see how he prayed. And if you go through the book, you will find that this is something that Nehemiah frequently did. Every time something came up, what does he do? You find him over and over and over again going to God in prayer. So Nehemiah faces these various obstacles that arose. And we, of course, noted how that there were others as well. Sin, he acknowledged in his prayer there in chapter 1, in verses 6 through 7, he acknowledges his sins. He acknowledges his family's sins. He acknowledges the people's sins. We know that this was an obstacle. Fear, chapter 2 and verse 2. He feared the king. He feared the situation. And we can look at many other obstacles that come about throughout the book. And you might recall those. And if you'd like further information on the things we looked at, then just let me know. But you go through the book and you see various obstacles that they faced. And then we talked about solutions that Nehemiah, of course, he and the people had. The greatest, and the title of this morning's lesson is taken from this verse, is in Nehemiah 4 and verse 6, where Nehemiah would say, "So built we the wall, and all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof." And note here, "For the people had a mind to work." A mind to work, brothers and sisters. That is what we want to look at this morning. Having a mind to work, an attitude, if you will, an intent, a desire to do that which is needed. They accomplished indeed much, brothers and sisters. As we see here, the wall was rebuilt, Nehemiah 6 and verse 15, something that should impress all of us. "So the wall was finished in the 25th day of the month, Elul, In 52 days, 52 days, brothers and sisters, it took them to rebuild these things. 52 days. And keep in mind, as you think on that, keep in mind that what we read over in chapter 1 and verse 3. "And they said unto him, The remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire." This was a difficult situation, and it took them 52 days to accomplish this. In a recent discussion, I think I may mention this the other day, but in a recent discussion with someone about this very book, and all, it was mentioned about how some would use that to then, jump off into the idea of building a new building. Brothers and sisters, it is nice to have a new building. It is nice to have some elaborate, wonderful-looking new building that with a beautiful auditorium and all those things. But brothers and sisters, that isn't the key, is it? What is the key? The key is not the building. Too many people get wrapped up in the building, the church, as many will refer to it. We understand, if we look biblically, that the church doesn't reply to the building. This is just a building. The church replies to us, the people. We are the church. We are the ones that... It is about the church, building the church up, not building a building. Brothers and sisters, I like a nice building as much as anybody else. But to be honest, I don't really care about the building per se. I mean, we want to take care of the building, don't get me wrong about that. We want a nice place to meet, but what matters is that we are doing what God would have us to do, that we are being what God would have us to be. And indeed, Nehemiah and the people, they accomplished this rebuilding of the wall. They also, and you can go back and look in Nehemiah 8 and following, the chapters following, and you can see how they restored the worship of God. They restored things in that area. Brothers and sisters, you and I, just as they did in that time, we can accomplish many things. We can accomplish great things. And this morning, I want to speak a bit about that. One of the things I enjoyed about the class is, and as I indicated when we were beginning to look at this subject, I indicated about the desiring to do a lesson, a sermon on this, and getting that feedback from you. Getting those ideas from you as to what goals you might have. What goals the church has. And as was indicated, John Benton in the class had mentioned, and rightly so, that our ultimate goal is what? Our ultimate goal is to get to heaven, isn't it? We need to understand, as we start to look at these goals, as we start to look at the various goals that we have, that to accomplish any goal, whether we're talking spiritually or whether we're talking about just out in the world in our daily lives, and we all have goals, don't we? About things we want to accomplish over the next week or the next month or the next year or 10 years or however long it may be, we have goals. In order to accomplish any of them, we must know what it is, what our goals are. Know where we are going, brothers and sisters. Know where we are. Planning is a key part of that. And again, as I've already alluded to, our ultimate goal is indeed to get to heaven. Individually, every one of us hopefully desire to get to heaven, don't we? Brothers and sisters, I don't often do this, but this morning I want to give you the opportunity. Is there anyone here that does not want to get to heaven? I don't see any hands raised, so I'm going to take it that every one of us, as I know, as I am confident in saying, that every one of us want to get to heaven. We desire that. We desire to do so as individuals, but hopefully we desire to do so as a group, don't we? We desire, and I again trust that this is true, that we desire to take as many as we can with us. We desire not only to get each other to heaven, but we want to take others with us, don't we? I can trust that every one of us can think of several people, multiple people that we know personally that we want them in heaven. We want to see them saved. We want to see them one day spend all of eternity in heaven. It is our desire to see that. I know I can think of many people that I know, that I look at and I know they are not in Christ. They are not faithful to Christ. Some having never obeyed the gospel, some simply not being faithful. And I desire for them to be in heaven. I know that I look at you, and I look at the faithful, and I see faithful Christians, and I desire for you to be in heaven. It is my goal, and I trust and hope that it is your goal. Another goal, and again, we discussed this, and that is to grow spiritually. And brothers and sisters, it is key. This is the key to what we just mentioned, getting to heaven, and what we will further discuss as we go through this. In order to accomplish any of these goals that we have, what must we do? We must grow spiritually. The Bible teaches us this very plainly, that growing spiritually is crucial. Does the Bible teach, brothers and sisters, does the Bible tell us that, well, obey the gospel, you come forward, the invitation will be given in a few moments, and we give people the opportunity in order to be saved. And we know the Bible tells us that we must hear the word, Romans 10, verse 17, believe in Christ, John 3, and verse 16, repent of our sins, Acts 3, verse 19, confess Him to be the Christ, Matthew 10, verses 32 and 33, that we must be baptized, immersed in water for the remission of our sins, Acts 2, verse 38. We know that we must do this, and upon doing so, we are told that we are added to the church by the Lord, Acts 2, verse 41, verse 47. We understand these things, but brothers and sisters, does it then say that that's all that matters, and once we have done so, we are added to the church and nothing else matters? We've punched our ticket, we're okay, we can go about our business, live our lives the way we want to, do whatever comes to our hearts. Eat, drink, and be merry, so to speak. Does the Bible teach us that? No. What does the Bible tell us that we must do? Indeed, we noted, of course, that they obeyed the gospel in Acts 2. We find in verse 37 there at the end of it that they cried out, having heard Peter and the other apostles as well, that having heard the sermon preached, it says Peter preached to them, beginning there in Acts 2 and verse 14, that Peter preached, stood up and preached to them. And told them that ultimately coming there in verse 36 to the fact that they had crucified Christ, the Son of God, whom God had raised up, whom He had exalted. God had exalted. They cried out there at the end of verse 37, men and brethren, what shall we do? What is it we must do in order to be saved? We recognize we're guilty of this. What do we need to do to fix it? Verses 38 and 39, Peter answered them, told them they must repent and be baptized, every one of them, for the remission of their sins. They were told that they must do this. And we see further that he taught them in verse 40. And then we're told in verse 41 that then they that gladly received His word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them, it says, King James Version, note it is in italics, when we look in conjunction with verse 47, they were added unto the church, about 3,000 souls. Brothers and sisters, they were to do this, and upon doing so, they were added to the church. But it doesn't stop there. What does it say in verse 42? And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayers. Why? They'd obeyed the gospel. They'd been added to the church by the Lord. Couldn't they just go on about their business, do whatever came to their minds? No. They had to remain faithful. They had to continue to grow. And it is God's desire for us today to continue to grow spiritually, to become stronger. How sad it is, brothers and sisters, to see someone obey the gospel. That is truly a joy, by the way, to see someone obey the gospel. But to see them do so, and year after year after year go by, that they don't grow the least bit. They know no more about the word than the day they obeyed the gospel. They are no stronger in the faith than when they first obeyed the gospel. They continue as though nothing has changed. Brothers and sisters, it is truly sad to see such. And the Bible teaches us that in order to be pleasing to God, in order to ultimately reach that ultimate goal of getting to heaven, then we must indeed grow spiritually. Further, we desire, don't we, to grow numerically. It is my desire. I've stated before, and I know others, again, John Benton had mentioned it in the Bible class, how, and I know that others do. I've had others express this desire to grow numerically. Again, keep in mind the key, grow spiritually. As we grow spiritually, what are we going to do? We're going to do more to help grow numerically. The Bible does teach us to grow numerically, doesn't it? When we think of such texts as the Great Commission given in Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20, where Jesus states in verse 18 that he has all power in heaven and earth, that he tells them and ultimately tells us through the word to go into all the world and preach the gospel. I know I'm quoting from Mark 16, verses 15 and 16, the same thing. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned or condemned. What is he talking about there? He's talking about growth. Now, we know he's talking about saving souls. Don't get me wrong. I understand that. That's what it's about. It's not about just strictly the amount of people we can fit into a building. But we have a need to grow numerically, and we desire to have more people. Going back to that desire to take as many people to heaven with us as we possibly can. As we do so, we grow. As we bring people to the truth, we grow, brothers and sisters. But we think about obstacles, don't we? Let's get personal here with us here in Sedalia. Think about some obstacles that we face. Just as Nehemiah did, and we think back to Nehemiah chapter 1 and the obstacles which he faced. Remember what we mentioned first? The conditions? Is that not an obstacle for us today when we think of the conditions? Looking about us, we think about the condition of the church here. And we think how we're not a large congregation. We don't have a lot of people here. And we see the condition, and it is a discouragement, isn't it? This morning we know that we have several who are out. And we look about and we think, well, there's just not that many of us. Oh, how terrible it is. I know, brothers and sisters, believe me, I get discouraged when I think about that there are a few. And I know you do, because I have various ones who will express the same idea to me. Nehemiah saw this. How did he respond? Did he throw up his hand and say, oh, just too bad, can't be fixed? He wept, he mourned, didn't he? He prayed to God. And then he got about the work of fixing it. Brothers and sisters, we too, and not to jump ahead, we too need to recognize the condition. And I don't want to jump ahead, but I want us to realize that conditions aren't always as bad as we might think they are. We see that not only did Nehemiah face the situation, the obstacle of the conditions, but again, the sin that he had. Brothers and sisters, I'm not standing here this morning pointing fingers and saying, oh, look at all these sinners. I'm not suggesting that. But neither am I going to say that any of us can go about in our lives, once we've reached that age of accountability, and say, we never sin. We never do anything that is wrong. Because I assure you, from top to bottom, side to side, every one of us stumbles. Every one of us fails from time to time to be what God would have us to be. Now, it may be in a different area for you, and I trust it is, but every one of us sins. Every one of us falls short and needs to correct that. Indeed, Paul would write in Romans 3 and verse 23 that all have sinned And that doesn't end, brothers and sisters, though we certainly wish it would once we obey the gospel. It doesn't just end, because if it did, why in the world would God provide that means by which for us to overcome those sins? As we noted in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9. Who's he talking to there? He's talking to, talking about the Christian who has stumbled, who has sinned, that he can go to God and seek forgiveness. And God has promised to forgive him. Fear. Nehemiah 2 and verse 2. Nehemiah faced his fear, didn't he? You and I have fears, do we not? Different things. And I'm not talking necessarily about the physical, like spiders or whatnot. I'm talking spiritually. We let fear sometimes get in the way, don't we? Let fear cause us not to be what God would have us to be. So we see that just as Nehemiah faced these and other obstacles, we today face those same things. But we see some things that are not included in the book of Nehemiah. Turn with me to the book of 2 Kings, chapter 6. 2 Kings, chapter 6, and we'll begin with verse 8. We find here in 2 Kings, chapter 6, and just kind of briefly paraphrasing what is going on, the king of Syria, it says, warred against Israel and took counsel with his servants, saying, in such and such place shall be my camp. And so he camps. He's planning on going up against the Israelites, planning on conquering them. But lo and behold, every time he sets up his camp, what happens? They know where he is. And he gets all upset and goes into this little fit because, well, how is it that they know? There must be a spy here among us. And his people say, no, none of us have betrayed you, king. It's the prophet over there. He tells even the things that you say in your bedchamber. The things you're saying in the most secret place. He reveals. He knows. So, okay, well, we'll go take care of this prophet. So they go. Look down with me, beginning in verse 14. Therefore sent he thither horses and chariots and a great host, and they came by night and compassed the city about. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone forth, behold, an host compassed the city both with horses and chariots, and his servant said unto him, alas, my master, how shall we do? What are we to do, master? We see here how that he saw the obstacles, didn't he? What did Elisha do? He prayed for his eyes to be opened. Brothers and sisters, Numbers chapter 13. We see another example. And we see how that 10 spies are sent in to spy out the land. Well, 12 spies, excuse me. But 12 spies are sent in. We know that 10 come back, and what do? Excuse me. Numbers 13, verses 26 and following. We see the spies are sent in. They come back, and 10 of them do what? They give a poor report. Oh, yes, we saw all this. This great land, all of these things truly is flowing with milk and honey. Look at all these things. Two men carrying stick with grapes hanging down, dragging. It's just as we've been told. But again, what did they see? They saw the obstacles. Oh, the Amalekites. You see these giants. What did he say? We are what? We are like grasshoppers. We're nothing. Verse 32, and they brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, the land through which we had gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof, and all the people that we saw in it are men of a great stature. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. We are nothing, is what they're saying. We couldn't accomplish anything. We can't do this. We looked, and it's just such a great land, and the people in there, they're so big and great, and they're all so strong, and we were nothing in our own eyes, and we were nothing in their eyes. And too often today, what do we do? We see the problem. We see those obstacles. And we say, we're nothing. We can't do this. We can't accomplish this. We can't fix anything. We can't grow. We can't grow spiritually. We can't grow numerically. We can't be what God would have us to be. We are nothing. Brothers and sisters, that is their problem. And too often, it is our problem. But just as in Nehemiah's day, there were solutions. We see in our day, there are solutions. Again, keep in mind that Nehemiah's greatest solution was what? And we could say many things. We could talk about his faith in God. We could talk about his trust in God, his prayer. We could talk about all these things. But brothers and sisters, with Nehemiah and with the people, what did they have? They had a mind to work. Nehemiah 4 and verse 6. We see there that he stated the people had a mind to work. But you can go back and look in the very beginning and read through the first couple of chapters of Nehemiah. And what do we find with Nehemiah? Nehemiah had a mind to work, didn't he? It doesn't say in those two chapters, it doesn't say Nehemiah had a mind to work, but we see in his actions that he had a mind to get done what needed to get done. He had a mind, an intent, a desire, the will to do what needed to be done, to face those obstacles, to solve those things. And we today need to have a mind to work, brothers and sisters. We need to look at the things that are there, the problems that we face, the obstacles that are between us and the solution, between us and the goal. And we need to have a mind to overcome those things. Solution is to open our eyes. Nehemiah had this same attitude, didn't he? To recognize the situation. What was the very first thing there in chapter 1 that he did? In verse 2, what did he do? He asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. He had a desire to know what is the situation. He asked. We see in chapter 2, in verse 5, in verse 7, in verses 12 and following, what did he do? He had an intent to find out. He went and looked for himself. Got up during the night. Went, without announcing what he was doing, went and surveyed the situation. Opening his eyes. In 2 Kings 6, we looked at, brothers and sisters, what did Elias pray? What was his prayer? Lord, open his eyes. This servant who woke up, looked about, and said, look at all this great host, what are we going to do? The prophet said, Lord, open his eyes that he may see. And brothers and sisters, I want us, and I pray this morning that we will open our eyes and see. And I'm not talking about looking at some great host that's surrounding the building that with swords and on horses or any of that. I'm talking about looking at the situation. As I mentioned on Wednesday evening, you'll note on the board the attendance for last Sunday. And you'll notice that it really isn't what we had in here, is it? It's not, I can assure you. What it is a compilation, and it's the English-speaking and our Hispanic-speaking brethren all together. That's what we had. But brothers and sisters, are we not all Christians? Are we not all here in Sedalia? Is it not our desire to work together to build up the kingdom, to strengthen one another, to help one another get to heaven? It certainly should be. And I know that, as has been the case with our brethren meeting in the annex next door, it's not always to keep track, always easy to keep track of the number of people who are there. But as of course next Sunday they will begin meeting in the main building here, and I would encourage you to check out the room. It looks very nice, that as it has been fixed. But they will be meeting there, and that will make it, I trust, easier to keep track of, and perhaps will help us to view ourselves not as small as we might have previously thought. Brothers and sisters, another solution we see is to not focus on the obstacles. Too many times, again, whether we're talking about spiritual matters or we're talking about physical matters, what do? We see the goal that we have. Perhaps we like to build things. Perhaps we want to build a table or a chair, and we see what the ultimate goal is. But we see those obstacles. Oh, I'm not very good at building. Oh, I can't do that. Oh, I don't. It's going to cost me more money than I want to spend on it. Oh, it's not going to be good. The ultimate work won't be as nice as what somebody else would do. And we spend, rather than looking at the solutions, rather than going and building the table, we spend our time convincing ourselves how we can't do it. It's just too great for us. We simply are too small in our own eyes. Brothers and sisters, we look here and we desire to have the church here in Sedalia to grow. And what do? We spend our time saying we're too few. We can't do it. We don't have anyone who can accomplish this. But brothers and sisters, look about and recognize that we are more than what we sometimes give ourselves credit for. And we know that we have God with us, and when we are doing what He has told us to do, and He has told us to build up the kingdom wherever we might be, when we are doing what God has told us to do, there is no obstacle that is too great to be overcome. None. It is my intent that over this spring, as the weather is getting better, I know we had a pretty mild winter, but as the weather is surely getting better in the spring and in the summer and leading up to this fall, we're going to have a gospel meeting, a gospel campaign. We're going to have the school come up. And much will be done, accomplished during that time. Brothers and sisters, it is my intent to be doing things ahead of that meeting. Ahead of that, wanting to go out. And I've already talked to many here that it is my intent that we, as much as is possible, go out that week before and cover some of the area that will be covered. But even before that, even now, it is my intent to do so. To go out, to reach out to the lost, to reach out to the community, to bring people in, to grow this congregation. Likewise, it is my intent, I've asked some, and we'll talk to others, that it is my intent that we likewise also focus within, trying to encourage one another to be here. Olivia and I in the class were looking at honoring the Lord's Day and how we are not to forsake the assembling of ourselves, how we should encourage one another to be here. Look about you. I know, again, there are those who are sick this morning, unable to be here. We have members who are shut in. We think on them and they're not able to get out. We think about those who are traveling. And that comes up, we understand. But brothers and sisters, do you see anyone that perhaps none of those things are true? They just aren't here? Do you see them missing? Give them a call. Every one of us. And I'm pointing as many fingers, more fingers at myself than anybody else. Give them a call. Let them know. Don't give them a call and chew them out and say, you should have been here this morning. You terrible sinner. How terrible you are. Give them a call. Ask them how they're doing. Encourage them to be here. Ask them if they need anything. Brothers and sisters, I know, again, we're not a large congregation, but I was looking at a list of the members here, and you might be surprised how many members we have in this congregation. Some who just simply aren't being what they need to be. And brothers and sisters, understand that every one of us stumbles, every one of us falls. Every one of us needs encouragement. Maybe that's what they need. Let's do what we can to encourage them. And as we do that, and as we go out, and I am thankful for those who have volunteered in both those areas to do those things, to encourage, to take an active role, because we have some who are not physically able to get out and go as easily, though we all can reach out to the lost, because we all know someone personally, I'm quite certain, who is outside of the kingdom. But there are those who can't get up and go, but they can pick up the phone and encourage a brother or sister. And I'm thankful for them, and I'm thankful for those who likewise are willing to go and get out and go and to evangelize. And I want to encourage you this morning, if you're here, look at those areas. See what you can do. And every one of us, no matter what, can do something. Let's build this church up. Let's build the kingdom up here in Sedalia. Let's see what great things can be accomplished. Because brothers and sisters, there is no host, there is no obstacle, there is nothing that is greater than the God that we serve. And He has promised if we will be faithful to Him, if we will do what He has told us to do, He will not forsake us, He will not leave us, He will be there with us. As we see in Hebrews 13 and verse 5. This morning, if you're here, if you've never obeyed the gospel, we've already, of course, seen what the Bible teaches us that we must do in order to be saved, how we must hear, believe in Christ, repent of our sins, confess Him to be the Son of God, and of course, be baptized in water for the remission of our sins. If you're here, have you never done so, then make the choice to do so this morning. Or maybe you're here and you are a Christian, but maybe you've stumbled. You haven't been what you need to be. Maybe it's something we looked at this morning, or maybe it's something else. Whatever the case may be, He's promised if we're faithful to confess our faults, He's faithful to forgive us. If you have need, please come while we stand and while we sing.
Jesus is tenderly calling thee home, calling today.